solemn belief that you cannot come in the presence of the guy who created the universe. You cannot come in the presence of the God who spoke everything into existence and not feel something. If you've ever been in the presence of somebody that's charismatic, you know what that's like. You know, people say things about when they come into the room, do the room just lights up? Or great leaders, you want to follow them. People get so excited about people. I'm amazed at how little excitement we get about the King. Amen? This is the King. Not a king. And the Bible calls him King of Kings. So he's not a king. He's the King. Amen? Hallelujah. I'm going to do this a little different. We always stand for the reading of the word, but this is different. I'm not really preaching a message this morning. I just want to talk to you about a few things and then move right into our communion service. But we've been preaching for the last couple of weeks. This will be the third from Isaiah 9. Let me read that to you in verse 6. It says, "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given. And the government shall be upon his shoulder. His name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace there shall be no end. Upon the throne of David and upon the kingdom, to order it and to establish it with judgment and with justice from henceforth even forever, the zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this." The lighting's good, guys. "Unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given." There's a prophetic voice that we know around here that we're used to because we have copies of one of the prophecies that she gave over this area. Her name is Corrie Ten Boom. Most people associate her with the Hiding Place. But she had a very prophetic voice. And those of you that know about her prophecy over this area, without going into great detail, she talked about this being an epicenter for revival. The story goes something like this, that she was telling someone that God spoke to her, woke her up, spoke to her, and said that an epicenter of revival would come from Northwest Arkansas. And then she asked, "Where is Arkansas?" Someone told her it's in the United States. And some years later, she flew over this region. And God spoke to her and she came and prophesied somewhere, said north of Harrison, actually northwest of Harrison. Says she was standing in a ditch looking into a cattle field and prophesied a revival, a great revival, a great epicenter of revival. It's a powerful prophetic word. But Corrie wrote a lot of things. She didn't just speak to the prophetic future of the church. She spoke on almost every subject. And this is something that she wrote about Christmas. She said, "Who can add to Christmas? The perfect motive is that God so loved the world. The perfect gift is that he gave his only son. The only requirement is to believe in him, and the reward for that faith is you'll have eternal life." Simple, to the point, and powerful. I've noticed something over the years. The secular world will largely tolerate the celebration of baby Jesus. Now, I know there's been a lot of efforts lately and pushes to try to remove Christ from Christmas. That's really been going on since he left the planet. But by and large, secular society, come December 25th, not only will let you celebrate the birth of baby Jesus, they will celebrate the birth of baby Jesus. I mean, as long as he's a infant running from a tyrannical government without a political following, without points of view, as long as he's swaddled in a manger, in a stable, he's even somewhat a sympathetic character. So not only will they let you or allow you, without too much problem, to celebrate the birth of that Jesus, they'll join in. Especially if you'll throw in a Superstore gift card. Or maybe their favorite bottle of wine wrapped with some kind of whatever. There are all kinds of celebrations. They'll let you do that. They'll even sing with you. Oh, holy night. 'Tis the season. As long as you keep Christmas with platitudes like happy holidays and season's greetings, still most of them will even still let you say Merry Christmas. Now, I understand the far liberal left don't want you to do that, but for the most part, middle America, secular America, still will say Merry Christmas. They'll let you write it on the door, hang it on the wreaths. They'll celebrate baby Jesus. Because see, in baby Jesus, in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger, poses no real threat to their lifestyle. Baby Jesus, without a political following, baby Jesus, without a voice, poses no real threat to their lifestyle. They'll sing the song with you, joy to the world, the Lord has come. But if you make emphasis about the Lord has come, now we've set up an argument. We can go with you until you get to there, but the Lord has come? He's okay as a plastic figure in a nativity scene. But take him out. Put him on the world stage and make him Lord. Now you got a fight on your hands. Because if he's Lord, they're going to have to listen. If he's Lord, they're going to be accountable. If he's Lord, they're not calling the shots, so he can't be Lord. You make no mistake, the world will celebrate your baby Jesus, but they are diametrically opposed to your Lord Jesus. But we know he's Lord. See, to us, it's not just mouthing words. To us, it's not just saying joy to the Lord or joy to the world, the Lord has come. Well, we see, when we sing the Lord has come, we know the Lord has come. Amen. When we declare the Lord has come, we understand what that means. He didn't come to take away our fun. He came to give us life and give it more abundantly. Unto us a child is born. We understand the child in the manger, but unto us a son is given, and that son is Lord of all, and that Lord is the cause of us being free. We understand that it is his blood and his salvation that brings us to this, from this side we were opposed to God, to this side where God is on our side. We understand that he's Lord. Now listen, I understand it, because they always want proof, and proof is, it's a little bit like today's political climate. It doesn't really matter what kind of proof you show them. They've already made up their mind. But let me say something. For those few that are left, and I understand secular society won't take this as proof in many areas, but if you're interested, the Bible says he's Lord. John MacArthur made this statement. He said, if we could condense all the truths of Christmas into all three words, these would be the words, God with us. He said, we tend to focus our attention at Christmas on the infancy of Christ, but the greater truth of the holiday is his deity. More astonishing than a baby in a manger is the truth that this promised baby is the omnipotent creator of heaven and earth. That's the true Christmas miracle. Yeah, babies are cute, harmless, innocent, and without opinion. But he didn't stay a baby. So remove him from that manger. Now, we must prove. So here's what the Bible says. For those that will take this as proof, and we'll move on from here, but in one place it says, and from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead, the ruler of kings on earth, to him who loves us and has freed us from sin by his blood. Another place says, and Jesus came and said to them all authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. The King James says, all power in heaven and earth has been given unto me. The book of Revelation declares it like this, on his robe and on his thigh has name written, King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. That's what your Bible says. Now understand, secular proof, since they don't believe in the Bible, is hard to use what we hold so dearly to show them. But let me offer this. No human being ever has affected planet Earth like Jesus Christ. Amen. A writer once wrote it like this. He said, all the armies that ever marched, all the navies that were ever built, all the parliaments that ever sat, all the kings that ever reigned, all put together have not affected the life of mankind upon this earth as powerfully as has the one solitary life of Jesus of Nazareth. Can you prove it? I can. His name is written more times than any other name on planet Earth. It's come across more lips than any other name on planet Earth. Muhammad ain't even close. They were doing it for centuries. They were praying to Jesus before Muhammad was ever even birthed in the desert. Nobody has had the influence he had. The book that he wrote is the most requested book on planet Earth. It has been printed more times. It has been delivered more times. It has been bought and sold more times. And it will continue to be because it is the true, unadulterated Word of God. It's called the Bible. And it is now and forever the ultimate authority on everything that is life. There's nothing like it. There's nothing like him. He's been the topic of more conversations. He's been written and quoted more times in literature than any other voice ever on the planet. Jesus King. And if that's not enough for you, think about this. When he stepped into time, he split time in half, B.C. and A.D., before Christ and A.D., which is not, by the way, after death. It's Anno Domini, which means the year of our Lord. So think about this. When you pick up your phone, not just you, but every single person, every satanic worshiper, every single person on planet Earth, when they pick up their phone and it tells them it's December 22nd, what? 2019. It is telling them that it is December 22nd in the year of our Lord, 2019. Every time that somebody, when they wake up on, are you listening to me this morning? Hallelujah. Church, we're about to celebrate in a few days the turning over of a brand new year. It's going to happen in increments, but as it does on Wednesday morning, January 1st, when they wake up, no matter who they are, no matter who they worship, no matter where they're at, every single one of them is going to celebrate. It's been 2020 years since the birth of our Lord Jesus Christ. Somebody ought to give him a praise in this place this morning. Hallelujah. He is King. He is Lord. Now think about this. The message of the baby, and I close here. The message of the baby is that God said, I have to provide a way to reconcile man to myself. Now you hear me, someone was arguing with me about something I'd posted on Facebook yesterday or day before, and in that argument they made the statement that the theme of the Bible is ethics and morals and whatever, and he's going through this, and it's really a surface answer from someone that doesn't know what they're talking about, because the theme of the Bible is the advancement of the kingdom of God. The theme of the Bible has always been the salvation of man. Do you understand? You having morals and you having ethics and you doing what's right are byproducts of you following this God. But the theme is how God came down and saved mankind. So here it is. If you receive this God, you are now a king's kid. The Bible calls you, now listen, covered in his blood is simply, I read it to you when we started. You are now royalty. Now listen, I understand. I didn't grow up hearing that kind of thing, because we always thought that somehow if we were self-abasing and if we would talk about ourselves in the lowest common denominator, that somehow maybe God would be more merciful on us. But I'm telling you, Christ didn't die for a worm. He died for you. And you're not a worm. Your Bible says you were fearfully and wonderfully made. That's why I don't like it when people say, well, I'm just an old sinner saved by grace. No, ma'am. I used to be a sinner. But the day I got saved, all things were passed away. All things become new. I am not an old sinner. I am a child of the King. I am blood bought. Blood, are you listening to me this morning? I've been sanctified through the blood of Jesus Christ. That makes me royalty. That makes you royalty. Somebody ought to praise him in this house this morning. You're royalty. Well, I'm uncomfortable with that. Well, then you shouldn't be a Christian. Are you listening? Your Bible says you are a royal priesthood, a chosen generation. Not because of what you did, but because of what he did. Amen? Not because you're worthy, because he was worthy. You should give him credit where he's due. Oh, I don't have any problem believing you were a mess. I know exactly where I came from. The problem I have is thinking somehow that God couldn't take your mess like he took my mess and making though my sins were as scarlet, he washed them white as snow. The word says it like that, like this: for thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory. Don't you just love how God puts adjectives in there? Explanations. My favorite verse in the Bible is Ephesians 21. Now unto him who's able to do exceedingly abundantly above all. It's like, don't stop. How powerful. Exceedingly abundantly above all I'm able to ask or think. That's the King we're celebrating. The world may want to keep him in a manger. I didn't take him out and put him on a shelf. I decided to let him be Lord of my life. He's not my co-pilot. He's in the driver's seat. What we're about to do now is take communion. It's one of the two sacraments the Lord left for the church: Holy Communion and water baptism. I say this always because we always have visitors here. I'm thankful for that over the years. There's always someone visiting this church. When we take communion, we do what's called open communion. You don't have to be a member of our church to celebrate Christ with us. You don't have to have your name on a membership card. You don't have to be associated with any denomination. You just have to be blood bought. And if you're covered by the Lamb, Holy Ghost, just sometimes this preacher brain of mine just goes, when I hear a word, you ever thought about he's the Lion and the Lamb? That'll preach. Predator and prey, amen. Maybe I'll just do that in the new year. If you're covered, then you're welcome. Amen? So as our leadership begins to pass out the... Go ahead, guys. I have a little clip that I want you to listen to. I've used this man's words over the years many times. I've read them myself. Used to throw them in preaching every now and then a little bit. It's powerful. But the late S.M. Lockridge preached a message called That's My King some years ago. And during it, he has one of the most powerful excerpts describing what Christ is like that I've ever heard any other preacher, any other orator say.
I wonder if you know him. Don't try to mislead me. Do you know my King? The Bible says he's a king of the Jews. He's a king of righteousness. He's a king of the ages. He's a king of heaven. He's a king of glory. He's a king of kings, and he is the Lord of lords. Now that's my King. Well, no barriers can hinder him from pouring out his blessing. No means of measure can define his limitless love. No far-seeing telescope can bring into visibility the coastline of his shoreless supply. Well, he's enduringly strong. He's eternally steadfast. He's immortally graceful. He's imperially powerful. And he's impartially merciful. That's my King. He's God's Son. He's a sinner's Savior. He's the centerpiece of civilization. He's unparalleled. He's unprecedented. He's preeminent. Well, he's the loftiest idea in literature. He's the fundamental doctrine of true theology. He's the miracle of the age. He's the superlative of everything good. He's the only one able to supply all of our needs simultaneously. He's available for the tempted and the tried. He sympathizes and he saves. He heals the sick. He cleanses the lepers. He forgives sinners. He delivers the captives. He defends the feeble. He blesses the young. He serves the unfortunate. He regards the aged. He rewards the diligent and he beautifies the meek. Do you know him? Do you know my King? Well, my King is the key of knowledge. He's a wellspring of wisdom. He's a doorway of deliverance. He's a gateway of glory. He's a pathway of peace. He's a roadway of righteousness. He's a highway of holiness. His promise is sure. His light is matchless. His goodness is limitless. His mercy is everlasting. His love never changes. His word is enough. His grace is sufficient. His reign is righteous. His yoke is easy and his burden is light. Do you know him? Well, he's incomprehensible. He's invincible. He's irresistible. I'm come to tell you, the heavens of heaven cannot contain him, let alone a man explain him. You can't get him out of your mouth. You can't outlive him, and you can't live without him. Well, Pharisees couldn't stand him, but they found out they couldn't stop him. Pilate couldn't find any fault in him. The witnesses couldn't get their testimonies to agree. Herod couldn't kill him. Death couldn't handle him, and the grave couldn't hold him. That's my King. He always has been, and he always will be. I'm talking about he had no predecessor, and he'll have no successor. There was nobody before him, and there'll be nobody after him. You can't impeach him, and he's not going to resign. Overcomers. He's the governor of governors. He's the prince of princes. He's the king of kings. And he's the Lord.